that out of the way, I'm very, very happy to be to introduce Hrushikesh Maskar of Claremont Graduate University. Hrushikesh is a very prolific researcher in approximation theory and harmonic analysis and related areas. He's published a couple of books on polynomial approximation and approximation theory. He has well over 100 papers, very interesting stuff, and he's won a number of awards. I'm very excited to hear what he has to say today about the theory of machine learning. So without any further delay, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ryan, for the introduction, and thanks to all the organizers for inviting me, in particular Felix Kramer also. Please let me know if you don't hear me. And I think I will, I don't know how to turn off the video. Stop video. Okay, so there is a subtitle to my talk, My Efforts to Learn Machine Learning. And in the beginning, I was tempted to give the title itself as Learning Machine Learning, but then I thought this looks more formal. Okay. Now we have a problem. Okay, not much. So here is the outline of my talk. I want to give some observations first on classical machine learning theory. Then I want to present a new paper of mine about a direct method for function approximation on unknown manifolds. And then I want to talk about classification problem. I think it's probably better handled as a dual problem to function approximation. So here is machine learning and function approximation. Here is the basic problem of machine learning that I found in various books and papers which are listed here. So we are given some data which is sampled randomly from a probability distribution, and we are supposed to approximate this conditional expectation. Okay, there is an alternative formulation to this starting with F. And that, of course, as you see, got me salivating about this whole area. So it's to approximate a function F given the data of this form. So you just subtract Ci minus this expected value. And the Yi's are then the random samples out of the conditional distribution mu star, and epsilon I are mean zero samples. And so a typical example is we can think of classification also as a function approximation problem. You think of chi sub I as a characteristic function of class I, and then consider f of y to be the argmax of this expression. So no matter how cleverly you want to do classification, essentially you are approximating this function. Okay, so here is how the current paradigm looks like. People consider the loss functional. For example, in most of the textbook, they start with this least square loss. Then there is a nested sequence of hypothesis spaces. I tend to call them polynomials because of my habit, but they are not polynomials in general. For example, they could be neural networks with n neurons or radial basis function networks with certain number of neurons, or even deep networks, which was complexity is captured in terms of number of layers, number of neurons, number of weights, and so on, so on. So there are three kinds of errors which are associated with a element of V sub n. The generalization error is the expected value of the loss functional over all Z and Y. The empirical risk is the discretization of this. Oh, all of a sudden the window disappeared. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Oh, okay, because I stopped seeing anybody now. Oh, well, fine. So please let me know if I'm just talking to myself. So approximation error is the error between the expected value F and the model in the sense of this loss functional. And the degree of approximation is the infimum of this approximation error over all the V sub n's. So here is how typically things are done. We consider this hypothesis space in some universe of discourse, and because we are thinking about L2 norm for approximation and only the values of F is given, this is typically a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, which is where my mystery starts. So then one has to look at the best approximation from V sub N. Then there is another object which is the minimizer of the generalization error. And then there is another object which is the minimization of this optimization or empirical risk minimizer. Okay, this is the only thing which can be computed. These other two things cannot be computed. By the way, can you see my cursor here?
Yes.
Yes, yep.
So the way things work is we have to figure out what V sub N to use in order to set up this problem. So one has to study the degree of approximation first. And if that is acceptable, then we choose that V sub N. And then we compute this object. And then the difference between these two can be estimated from some statistical learning theory, like the BC theory. And as you see here, I find this completely mind-boggling. So there are two objects here which cannot be computed, and only one object which can be computed. The errors here are certainly related to each other, but the minimizers have no connection to each other. So the whole scheme looked very complicated, and especially because if I open the books of Zygmund or Timan or some such ancient books, there are plenty of procedures to construct an approximation directly from the samples to the function. So I cannot understand still why somebody has to go through this. Okay, so I will make three observations here about why one should possibly look at such a problem again, because after all, machine learning is so extraordinarily successful that if I say that one needs to revisit machine learning, it looks almost blasphemous. So I have collected three observations for this talk. One is my ancient passion about using global information to study local effects. Then this is something which I just learned to my amusement. And then this is another recent paper of mine. So here is an example about the global error bound being too insensitive. My usual way of putting this is good is better than best. So I'm not exactly out of the job market. If I am in the job market and you think I'm only good but not the best, please remember this. Okay, so here is a typical example which was proposed to me by Professor Karniadakis at Brown University. We consider such a function. There is a lot of research going on recently that deep networks can learn faster one of these ranges, I forgot which, and the other range takes longer. So I studied my old paradigms which I developed together with Jürgen Prestin and some other people. And then here is the log plot of error based on our trigonometric summability method. And here is the log plot which a postdoc of Dr. Karniadakis called Dr. Jagtap generated from me using a deep network with 10 fully connected layers with 30 neurons each. And this took 1752 seconds. My method, of course, took just 0.03 seconds. And you see that the error here is very large at the discontinuities. We can turn around and say that this is therefore detecting the discontinuities in a sharp way. But then it decreases very sharply as we go away from the singularities. And at nearly 70% of the points, the error here is less than 10 to the minus 5. Okay, here is another example. So they're trying to approximate absolute value of t using RELU networks. And clearly a shallow network with just two neurons can do the job perfectly. And because t is like this, then you can add depth to these networks if you like it. Arbitrary depth, just two neurons in each layer. and you will not only approximate but just reproduce this function exactly. But in this paper, the authors demonstrated that if you try to learn it in the classical way by setting the weights randomly in some way, then in 900 out of 1000 simulations, the network just produced a constant result. So in the paper, they call it dead on arrival. And of course, this is entirely the problem because of the learning procedure. It is not intrinsic to the problem of approximating this function. This function can be synthesized exactly. Okay. Then I was also concerned about the use of the degree of approximation. So as I understood it, to set up the optimization problem requires the knowledge of this hypothesis space. And the degree of approximation estimates are used only to figure out what space to use. And then people just forget about the degree of approximation, forget about how hard we work to obtain those degree of approximation estimates. And this is why I have a crying face here, because I worked pretty hard in finding such estimates. But then it was a problem because there were all kinds of estimates under all kinds of different hypotheses. There is the hyperbolic cross method, and then there are some dimension independent bounds, and then there are some classical approximation theory bounds and so on, and they all assume different conditions on the target functions. So it was not comparable. But then recently I found out that really it can be misleading. And I will describe to you a single class of functions for which two different proof methods give rise to different degree of approximation estimates. So to give you a background on this, in a paper with Tommy Pojo, we observed that one of the reasons why deep networks can be expected to do better than shallow networks is because if your function has a compositional structure like this, then you can use deep networks to exploit this compositional structure so that instead of approximating a function of four variables here, we are approximating at each stage a function of two variables. So the curse of dimensionality is overcome by this blessing of compositionality. Okay, so then RELU networks are very famous. So I decided to look at the degree of approximation by RELU networks. And it is easier to project this to the sphere because of homogeneity. And so instead of looking at this expression, one can go to one higher dimension and look at this expression on the sphere. Okay, when we go to the sphere, then the natural class to look at is the class of spherical polynomials. And by expanding the absolute value of t in different ultraspherical polynomials, we see that there is such a representation valid for all polynomials. I think we have seen such a representation also in one of the last talks by Professor Willeck from a completely different perspective. So the natural way to define the smoothness class is the class of all functions which admit such a representation. And from here, we can go in different directions. One can approximate this f using the by p using the data, and then discretize this integral using well-known quadrature formulas, which has nothing to do with the data. The other approach is to just start with this representation and think of this as a kind of probability measure and then use some probabilistic estimates. So we get two kinds of approximation errors for the same class of functions. If we start with the polynomial approximation approach, then we can prove that there are such centers and the coefficients. Here I can give everything absolutely explicitly. The x's are actually nothing to do with the target function. And the bk's I can express explicitly as linear combinations of the samples. And then I get this rate of approximation. If I go to the probability theory approach, then I can get this estimation, which is clearly substantially better than the previous one. But this proof is not constructive. And the parameters here are not necessarily selected by continuously dependent on the f. So it could be pretty unstable. But it gives a much better rate of approximation. So if you just focus on the degree of approximation estimate and not on the method in which it was corrected, it can be pretty misleading to select the right hypothesis space. So for example, going back to deep network, let's imagine that we have a full binary tree structure with 1024 inputs. And then for the same class of functions, the number of parameters to get an accuracy of epsilon, if you use this constructive approximation estimate, then you will get a very substantial improvement. If you just use the existence estimate, then there is still some improvement, of course, but not so substantial as before. So the moral of the story is, if we rely solely on the approximation error, forget everything about the proof or anything like that. Even if you know the same prior on the class of functions, it can still be misleading. Okay. Are there some questions about anything so far?
Yeah, now might be a good time to remind people that if you have questions during the talk, you can please put them into the chat or unmute yourself and interrupt if you're sure it's a good question.
Okay, I'm not so used to giving webinars, so I have absolutely no idea whether you are hearing me or not at all. And so please confirm from time to time that you are hearing me. Otherwise, it feels kind of silly.
Yep, can hear you.
Thank you. So this is now, therefore now I want to develop some alternative paradigms. So it doesn't look so complicated. It should be so easy that I can understand it. And so here is my goal. I want to start with the data and then directly construct an approximation. I don't care about finding the best of anything, but I would like to estimate the reconstruction error and make sure that this reconstruction error is at least a constant times the degree of approximation. Okay, so I want to avoid all this business about estimating the degree of approximation, estimating the statistical entity called the difference between the generalization error and the estimation error, and then this bias variance trade-off and all this extremely complicated affair. I want to go directly from here to the approximation and estimate the error. Okay, it's not to be confused. People are used to approximating the degree of approximation, and people are used to looking at me as an approximation theory guy. So it may be natural to expect that I'm going to produce a better degree of approximation. That's not my intention. Actually, in the case of the result which I'm going to show you, I know how to improve it. But I'm not so completely sure about the numerical stability. So it's not my intention to improve the degree of approximation. The degree of approximation theorems which we have are already optimal in many senses. I cannot do better, that's not my intention. And I'm also not looking for a better method than everything else. So I'm not claiming that the method which I'm going to propose will in every circumstance do a better job than everything else. And part of the reason I think is like this, that when we are developing theorems, we are developing them for a class of functions. But when we are testing it, then we are testing it on one specific example. So it's like approximating a special function versus proving a degree of approximation theorem. If you are trying to approximate sine of x, then of course it's an entire function of finite exponential class. As I mentioned in the books of Timan and Zygmund, there are lots of constructions to do that. But if you're trying to implement it on a GPU unit, then all of that is completely useless. One has to think of sine x as sine x, not as e to the x. And the techniques are completely different then. So it would be, I don't want to claim that my method is better than everything else. I will be happy only if it works in some nice cases. And this is one of the things which I am not able to figure out how to do feature selection. So one of the big advantages which deep nets seem to have is you don't have to do feature selections. They seem to select the features automatically. I have no idea how they do this. I don't think anybody has any idea about this. Okay, so I said a couple of times that there are algorithms in the book of Zygmund, also in Timan, on how to do function approximation based on values of the function. But there are some nuances here. If you look at many of these papers on approximation theory by deep networks and shallow networks and so on, which are still coming out, that approximation is taking place on a known domain, typically a cube, but sometimes also a sphere. And our data is not distributed densely, so you cannot really approximate on the whole cube with a data which lives just on, let's say, one line in that cube. The other thing to take into account is that we cannot choose these y sub j's judiciously. So in this old literature, the y sub j's were something like zeros of orthogonal polynomials or equidistant points or Driscoll-Healy points on the sphere or something like that. In machine learning, that we cannot do. And then there is noise in both the y sub j's and values of the function. And this was a reason which was given to me many, many times about why one has to do this empirical risk minimization. So there was a lot of things to do, and I tried to learn this step by step for over many, many years. And one of the things which got me quite excited was the introduction to diffusion geometry. So Mauro introduced me to this theory. There is a manifold assumption which says that our data is sampled from some compact connected, orientable, smooth, and all kinds of nice attributes, but it's an unknown manifold. And then let's say that this manifold is rigged so that the measure is, volume measure in my exposition, but it could be absolutely continuous with bounded densities. The manifold is supposed to be low dimensional submanifold of an ambient space. And I use the letter Q here because I use S to denote smoothness and D to denote generic dimension sometimes and sometimes distance. And Q is something which is not used too often. So there are two questions here. One is to understand the geometry of the manifold, and the other is the function approximation on the manifold. And one of the fundamental theorems in this theory is the theorem of Belkin and Yogi. So it says that if you have the Laplace-Beltrami operator on the manifold, then for a smooth function, we have this sort of approximation to the Laplacian of the manifold. Okay, if I think of only this integral expression and think of it as if I'm approximating F using this convolution with the Gaussian, then this theorem is a saturation theorem. It says that if the accuracy, if this integral expression is little of t, then the Laplacian must be zero. This reminded me all the time about a theorem called Voronovskaya theorem, which is some obscure theorem which one can find in a book by Lorentz on Bernstein polynomials, or my book on approximation theory. Okay, so the general approach in this manifold-based diffusion geometry approach is to construct a discretization of that integral called the graph Laplacian, find the eigendecomposition, and construct the approximation using this eigendecomposition directly or indirectly via Kernel. Lot of people have worked in this direction. There are probably hundreds of papers, but this is my hour of glory. So I will list some of my papers here. Okay. Oops. Yeah. So we are assuming that our data is IID sampled from a distribution with some smooth compact manifold. We will assume that there is a system of eigenfunctions of a suitable PDE, like the Laplace-Beltrami operator, which these eigenvalues, and these are computed approximately from a graph Laplacian. And then in these papers, there are a lot of estimates about how many samples will give you how much accuracy and what kind of dependence on the parameters in this graph Laplacian will have what effect. But anyway, in our theoretical consideration, we are thinking that here is my hypothesis space, the span of all the eigenfunctions with eigenvalues less than n. I will do my approximation in the soup norm. And this is the classical approximation theory way of defining smoothness classes. We look at the rate at which the distance of between f and this hypothesis class tends to zero. And then this gamma is called the smoothness of f. Okay, the construction is like this. We take a smooth low-pass filter and construct this summability kernel. In my work with Jurgen, this was e to the minus ikx. And so then it was a very well-known kind of summability kernel. Okay, then one of the fundamental theorems we proved was like this, that if y sub j's are sufficiently dense, then there are weights so that the quadrature formula holds exactly for polynomial, by the way, I've decided to call this diffusion polynomial because when I was working with Mauro, in my mind, it was polynomials. He was thinking in terms of heat diffusion. So calling it diffusion polynomials confused both of us equally. Okay, so quadrature formula is not a big deal, but the big deal is the Marcinkiewicz-Zygmund inequality that you can find its weights in such a stable manner. Okay, and then the algorithm is very simple. You just choose this W sub j's. It has nothing to do with the function, just the Y sub j's, and plug the values of the function together with noise and all that here. And then you get the approximation. The approximation is a linear process, so you can separate the noise from the real part. And then we can prove that if my f is smooth according to gamma, then with this choice of n, the approximation error given by the sigma sub n is like this. And this is the optimal in the sense of width. Well, so I thought I'm done. And I was very happy about it. And for a long time, then I was arguing, why don't you use this technique? But then slowly some shortcomings came up again. And so I'm back here. So in particular, you see that everything depends upon the construction of the graph Laplacian. To construct the graph Laplacian, we need to have all the test data in hand. So it is a semi-supervised learning. The labels are not there, but the test data has to be there. And then because we are doing the approximation, we don't really know an infinite system of eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. And in practice, people were using this only for the first three or four eigenfunctions. I mean, the quadrature formula was, it was not easy to compute it if we go higher. And then the error in the approximation of these objects by the graph Laplacian is very sensitive to the choice of some parameters. And then because this error is so sensitive, it could destroy the approximation error. Okay. So that was a PT. So I thought I'm done completely and got the final solution, but it's not at all final. So then the question is, can I approximate F directly, not doing any eigen decomposition, saturation, not even trying to approximate the manifold? So there are now some methods where people try to approximate an atlas on the manifold, something which I think Alex Kloninger has done, also Schmidt-Heber has done. And there are other methods like trying to approximate the tangent spaces to the manifold at different points and find a covering, something like the geometric multi-resolution analysis advocated by Mauro. And Haotian Wu sent me some papers of his on the subject also, which don't use eigen decomposition. But nevertheless, they are trying to approximate the manifold. But please remember that the whole business came because the manifold was in our head. So I want to do things directly. I don't want, of course, in proving theorems, I will assume that the data lies on the manifold, but the method itself should not use this assumption. Oh, now it works. So can everybody still hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good. Okay. Thank you. So here is a one-shot method to do things. It depends upon Hermite functions, which are my childhood friends. So they are normally they are defined by Rodriguez formula, but computationally to some moderate degrees, this is a better way to do this, to define them recursively with these initial conditions. And you can see easily that they have the form where the psi sub j is a polynomial of degree j multiplied by this weight function. They form an orthonormal family on the real line. Then I introduced these parameters d, d, r by this generating function and developed this projection operator. Okay. It looks opaque, and I would like to refer to my paper to see why it is important and what is going on here. But right now, I think it's probably better to keep it mysterious rather than overwhelming everybody with minute details about the Hermite functions. Besides, it would be nice to get my book on weighted polynomial approximation to sell. Okay, so with that, with these projection operators, I want to define a summability operator like this, but this time with square root of m instead of m. That's more for theoretical reasons. In practice, of course, one can redefine this h and write it as m over n as before. But the important thing is that this h should be one in the neighborhood of the origin. If it is not one and just a smooth function, then the theory will not work. And as I demonstrated before, also the practice will not work. Okay, so here is the main theorem. I start again with a smooth compact Riemannian manifold. It's unknown to me. Mu star is the volume measure of X. These are noisy samples. They consist of two parts. One is the random samples, and then there are other random samples. But now I want to deal with the joint distribution. The marginal distribution is assumed to be absolutely continuous with the volume measure. So this is designed to take into account the fact that there is noise everywhere. There is noise in the selection of y's, and there is noise in the selection of the function also. The manifold assumption is just in our head. The actual observations are probably coming from a neighborhood of the manifold. Okay, but nevertheless, we can imagine that there is a point on the manifold and there is a function behind it, and now I want to approximate this function. Okay, the method is again very simple, very similar to what I just presented before in the context of diffusion geometry techniques. But this time, this is not a database kernel. This is a kernel defined entirely in terms of Hermite functions. It has nothing to do with the data, nothing to do with the function or anything like that. It just a straightforward kernel. You do need to know the dimension of the manifold, and there are tunable parameters n and alpha. In the back of my mind, this alpha is always one, but it's a technicality which I had to introduce to make the theorem look beautiful. So anyway, here is now my construction. It's a very straightforward, simple construction. And now I want to define the smoothness class. The way to do this is to go back to my book on weighted polynomial approximation and define the smoothness class first on the Euclidean space, then make some rotations to bring it to an affine space. And then when you come to the manifold, then use the tangent spaces at every point as those affine spaces. And this gives you a smoothness class on the manifold. So for example, if gamma is an integer, then the class contains all the gamma times continuously differentiable functions on the manifold. It can contain non-differentiable functions also. For example, W1 will contain all the Lipschitz continuous functions. It is well known in approximation theory that W1 is not equal to this class. Okay, and then this is the theorem. I wanted to use, not to put any restriction on gamma. So instead of saying that gamma should be less than 2, I want to say that there is an extra parameter alpha which is less than this. Then for every small delta, if the number of samples is greater than this object, then with high probability, this approximation which I defined before will approximate the density of the data with respect to the volume measure times the target function. And this is the rate of approximation. This constant depends only on the dimension, only on the manifold inside and the dimension of the ambient space, but nothing else, not the function and not the data. Okay, so we have this rate of approximation. There is no upper limit on gamma, but there is a relationship between alpha and gamma which limits this to 4. But this is not a saturation theorem. Unlike in the case of Belkin-Yogi theorem, it's not proved that if this is improved, then this has to be trivial in some sense. Okay. So here are some consequences. One is that if I set my f to be 1, then I get an approximation to f sub 0, the density function. This is not a positive kernel, so it's not the run-of-the-mill probability density estimation. In particular, once more, there is no saturation coming here. Typically, if you use a positive kernel here to make it into a probability density itself, then there are old theorems by Ron DeVore and so on, which say that this cannot be improved by more than 1 over the square root of n. But here there is no such saturation, and that's because we are not using a positive kernel. Of course, the f sub 0 is positive. So if you insist on having a positive function as an approximator, you can just put an absolute value around this expression. It will just improve the order of approximation. Okay, then if the samples are taken from the probability distribution, from the volume measure itself, then the same construction gives me the approximation to f, and again with the same rate. Okay, so it looks like I have solved the problem which I wanted to solve. Now we have a direct construction for function approximation from the data. We need to assume the manifold in order to prove a theorem, but the construction of this object does not involve any knowledge about where the data is. So remember that this is our construction. It has nothing to do with the manifold, nothing to do with anything about it, except for the dimension of the manifold. Okay. So here is a toy example, I think, of the helix. It's not a closed Riemannian manifold, and therefore there will be some endpoint effects as usual. And I want to consider, okay, this is the helix. I want to consider this function. And as my first example, my noisy samples are given by this expression, where this epsilon is a pretty large normal variable with variance 1.5. Sorry, the standard deviation 1.5. So the way this example is written, you can imagine that every x, y, and z is perturbed by a normal variable with standard deviation half. And then you are getting evaluating this function on a neighborhood of the actual manifold. And this factor is essential to make sure that the expected value of this is given by this Ft. Okay, so here is the actual function as a function of t. And then the blue dots denote the noisy samples. And you see that the noisy samples are practically drowning the actual function inside. And of course, the approximation after one trial is not going to be good. but the result was a probabilistic estimate. If I make an average of all the estimates I get out of this method, then I get a decent approximation to the original function. In spite of this very large noise and in spite of the data not being on the manifold at all, but in some very large neighborhood of it. So I took 256 random training points, tested it on 2048 equidistant test points. And this picture shows you the average of estimates in 100 trials. Here is a little bit more modest example. So I just make an additive noise to the function, because I wanted to see what happens with one trial. And this is a typical trial. And just to make sure that I just did not just get lucky, I plotted again the sorted histogram of the average errors. And there is some effect of the endpoints, but for the most part, this is less than 0.8 of, or 0.7 of the variance. Okay, so it is a pretty stable procedure. It can withstand the noise and, okay. But then I wanted a real life example. So I was pestering Dima Batenko, also Alex Kloninger, to produce something for me, please. And then Dima Batenko talked with one of his colleagues at Tel Aviv University, and they came up with this example. So this is based on a data collected by NASA about studying aerosols above the clouds. And so I don't know what this picture stands for, but I don't have to understand what I'm doing. In any case, this is not really my work yet. It's still work by Segal Rosenheimer. So Dima used 83,600 simulated observations. The observations are in 2014 dimensional space. And Segal Rosenheimer had trained a deep network using more than 800,000 data points. Okay. There are six functions to be approximated. They are called this. I really don't care what it means, but these are the six functions. And the criterion in that field to judge the accuracy is given by R square. It's written typically as R squared in the mathematical sense, but this is not a positive expression. The closer it is to one, the better our result is, because if it is one, then it means that the mean squared error is zero, and we have exactly reproduced everything. If it is negative, then it is bad, because it means that we did not have to go through the process at all. We just took the average of the readings and it gives a better result already. So negative is bad, close to one is good. And here is the comparison which Dima Batenko produced for me. The results are written as 100 times the R square with n equal to one. Remember n was the n squared was the degree of the polynomial. He considered a five-dimensional manifold and took alpha to be one and took 95% training data. This means that the deep network was trained using 800,000 plus points, but Dima dealt with 83,000 points. He divided it into 95% training data, and everything was tested on the rest of the 5% training data. And you can see that our method already beats the deep network in some cases, like here, and here it is even more substantial, and here it is even more substantial. Here it is not so good, the deep network win, but then they are trained with a lot more points here. And the results are decent enough to prompt me to badger Dima Batenko once more to please work a little bit harder on this, then maybe something will come up better. Here the degree four is used, the lower dimensional manifold and higher training data, and the results are somewhat comparable here. So as I said, it is not going to be the best method for everything. That's not the intention. That cannot be done because we are looking at a very special problem here, and special purpose techniques can always be used. But here is something which tells me that this method is not complete nonsense. It does work in real life examples, and it gives decent results, comparable to deep networks, in fact. Okay, so to summarize this, we have a complete solution of the problem directly from the data. The construction is completely universal. It assumes nothing at all about the function. The theorems will assume many things, but the construction does not. Then the error bounds don't have a saturation. So it could well be that the rates which I have obtained are artifacts of the proof. It could be better without F being trivial. And in fact, as I said, I have ideas on how to improve upon this degree, but I don't know about computational efficiency. The approximation is on the entire manifold, so we don't need to know the entire test data in advance. We have done automatically an out-of-sample extension in this case. And then once more, we don't use any eigendecomposition. We don't need to know anything about the manifold. We are not even trying to approximate anything about the manifold. All we need to know is the dimension and smoothness. Okay. I will take a pause here. Are there some questions and discussions at this point? Hello?
Maybe just a quick question, Hrishikesh. Could you go back to the experimental results?
Yeah,
right here. So I'm just wondering, it seems like the results with the 95% training data are doing better. Is that just overfitting or is something else going on?
I don't know yet. This was given to me just last Monday.
Mm-hmm.
It's the conjecture that this could well be overfitting. The 99% could be overfitting. That is possible. But this is just a work which is starting right now. It needs to be evaluated further if there is interest in this. My intention was only to get a sanity check.
No, I understand. I was just curious. Thanks.
Thank you. My other hidden intention was just to make sure people are able to hear me. It looks kind of silly to just talk with myself. I don't see any of you here.
That's the beauty of pandemic seminars.
Right. Okay. So I'm in this position, but when I come to the last slide, then I will go back to the crying position. Okay, but here is another topic. As I mentioned, these things which I was mentioning talk about function approximation, and classification is certainly a function approximation problem in theory. But because the class boundaries are not smooth and they might touch each other, then the classification function is not a smooth function. So it's not so, there is some nagging discomfort in using approximation theory techniques for classification. And then I have the feeling that one should really look at classification as a dual problem. And then together with Alex Kloninger, we recently explored this idea called active clustering or active learning. So we are not given any of the labels on any of the data. We are going to judiciously choose labels on the data. And therefore, by minimum number of samples necessary, we will try to do a very accurate classification. So the idea is more coming from my years and years and years of teaching remedial algebra and calculus. We construct specifically designed examples. We don't do every problem in the book that will give me a big headache. But I would choose two or three problems which I think covers everything. And so why can't we do the same thing with classification? Just ask for labels at the right points and then everything is learned. Okay. So once more, my I have a sample from a probability measure on R to the Q. These are my labels, and these are some conditional probabilities. So it represents the probability that something will belong to a class K. And then I can write this measure as the sum of these conditional probabilities. So the idea is that if I can find the support of each of these measures and the number of classes, then I'm done, because then I will simply ask one label from each of the supports, and then I'm done completely. So then everybody else will have a label. Okay, that's really a very ancient search. Already in the Upanishads, you find this question, knowing what will everything become known. So I like this very much. Okay, if I have to make a simplifying assumption for my presentation, the whole point of our paper was to avoid this. So we have developed a multi-scale method, in which case, when the minimal separation tends to zero. But for exposition, I'm going to assume that these supports are separated. Okay, and here is the main result, where a lot of details are suppressed. So we have again a thresholding parameter theta, and n has to satisfy this, and this inequality dependent on the number of data points. Phi n is not the same as the phi n which I showed before, but it is a precursor of that. It's a localized kernel defined with the tensor product of Hermite polynomials. And then we define this set where this sum is exceeds a threshold from the maximum of this sum over the samples. In the back of my mind, the mu sub k's are Dirac deltas. And then this problem which I'm trying to solve here is the problem of super resolution. So these are like Dirac deltas, and then I want to find out how many signals are there and how many, where are the components. So in a previous paper with Charles Chui, I developed such a technique using an old kernel which I had developed with Jürgen Christin. And that was the motivation behind this result. So you look at where this object is large, because this is a localized kernel. This will be large if you are close to this data point. And then just by technique similar to this older paper with Charles on super resolution, this set is a disjoint union of these clusters. These clusters are separated by eta also. And then these are in some sense approximations to the support of mu sub k. Please note that this is a positive kernel now. If I omit this square, then I will get a good approximation to mu sub k, but because of oscillations, it could happen that some of the points are declared to be zero when they should be in the support of mu sub k. Okay, so we decided to use the positive kernel. It's not our objective to approximate mu sub k, we just want to find a support. Okay, one interesting feature here is that the number of classes is an output of the theorem. It's not assumed in advance. So the way to do this is we construct such set, and then we create a graph and do some graph clustering algorithms. And then out of the components of that graph, we take one label. And then we use another paper of mine with Alex Kloninger to figure out whether that label is reliable or not. If the label is reliable, then we will call that point a certain point. If not, then it is uncertain point. So certain points are certain points are uncertain points. Okay, here is a toy example. We take the two moons data set, and we just, using this procedure, decide that we want to take a label at these green dots. If you use degree 9 polynomials, then there is still a little bit confusion here. If you use degree 16, then there is a perfect classification with just one selected query. It's not a randomly selected query. It is a judiciously selected point at which the label is sought. So, okay. Then here is a more realistic example. The MNIST data set, as everybody knows, consists of handwritten digits. Alex chose the feature space by a variational autoencoder. And then the idea was to use what is called EPP score to evaluate this classification. So when we are, there is a hierarchy here, some of the digits tend to get confused more often than some others. And so if we clump them together to create a coarse data, then it turns out that the EPP score is very good if we are choosing our labels at what we have called certain points or confident points. And if we don't care about that, then the EPP score diminishes a little bit, but it's still pretty good, above 0.8. And if we go to the finer level, then it's still good, about 0.7. In our paper, I think there is a comparison with some other techniques. Okay, here is a more serious example. We take a hyperspectral image from Salinas A. It has 204 bands and 3 classes. One of them is subdivided into 4 classes. And once more, here is the EPP score on all the points. And here is the EPP score about those points for which the prediction was considered confident. This compares far better than another paper written by Mauro Maggioni and one of his collaborators previous to our paper. We just need 500 samples to get a near perfect EPP score. In their case, they needed much more. Plus, their procedure was far more complicated than ours. So, to conclude, we have solved the basic problem of function approximation. It can be solved directly and easily. We can think of classification as a problem of separating measures. So, sort of a dual problem to function approximation. So we can use the same sort of techniques in a dual manner to do classification. And here is still the crying part or the thinking part. The method which I have developed so far does not give me a representation of the function. It just gives me an approximation. So I can approximate the function, but I cannot say that here are the finitely many parameters which encode the function. Then again, the manifold assumption is just in the back of our mind. It's useful to prove theorems, but it may not be reality. So how can we drop the assumption? There is a recent paper by Alex and one of his postdocs or PhD students, I don't remember. But they are trying to make this assumption that let's say that our function depends only on the projection of the point to some manifold. And I think the techniques which I have described here will give better results in that direction, but I'm still discussing this with Alex. And then this is a nagging problem for me. I want to understand how the feature selection is done, what should features mean, and how can a poor mathematician try to do this? For example, I have diabetes, and then it takes an endocrinologist to prescribe the blood test. I cannot figure out myself what kind of test to take, and then how to choose these hyperparameters n and the dimension of the manifold and alpha. And it could be that if we use anisotropic kernels, then we can get better results. And in that case, it's an even harder estimation problem. So there are a lot of things to do here. It will be, I will be shooting myself in the foot if I say that everything is solved, because then it's like saying that please don't give me any other grant anymore. I have done everything already. I still need grants. Okay, thank you very much for your attention, and I will very much appreciate criticism, pent up questions in private discussion. In public discussion, I would appreciate simple questions. Thank you.
Thanks.
Oh, now I see Peter.
Thank you, Hrushikesh.
You're welcome.
So while people think about questions, I just had one quick one about that, the last part of